inheritance. To the good one be glory on this feast, in all the days of our lives and forever.
Amen.
We worship and praise you, O only begotten Son. You descended into the darkness of the tombs and worked wonders in the realm of the dead. By your resurrection, you freed the captives, and by your voice, you awakened the righteous and the just who had gone to the rest in the sleep of death. You gathered the nations to worship you and proclaim your salvation. They rejoiced and cried out. On Friday, the king endured pain and was crucified, and today victory has been achieved by his resurrection. On Friday, the lance pierced his side, and today, in his compassion, the water of baptism flowed. On Friday, he was crowned with thorns, and today, he has adorned his church with the crown of splendor. Today is the day of rejoicing in the resurrection. Today is the day of rejoicing for all who have gone to the rest, in the hope of the resurrection. Today, with the fragrance of this incense, the church and her children celebrate and sing hymns of glory, saying, O Creator of life, you have saved us by your passion and have given us life by your resurrection. Now renew our image by your grace, clothe our bodies with the power of the Spirit, so that we may shine in your own glory and his light to see you, the true bridegroom. In your grace, make us and all the faithful departed worthy of your heavenly kingdom, that we may raise glory and thanks to you, dear Father, your Holy Spirit, forever.
Now, Lord, accept our incense and fill us.
may never cease in giving thanks to you forever.
Thank you.
life and salvation for our soul.
Remain silent, O listeners, for the Holy Gospel is about to be proclaimed to you. Listen and give glory and thanks to the Word of the living God.
Now on that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem, and talking with each other about all these things that had happened. While they were talking and discussing, Jesus himself came near and went with them. But their eyes were kept from recognizing him. And he said to them, "What are you discussing with each other while you walk along?" They stood still, looking sad. Then one of them, whose name was Cleopas, answered him, "Are you the only stranger in Jerusalem who does not know the things that have taken place there in these days?" He asked them, "What things?" They replied, "The things about Jesus of Nazareth, who was a prophet, mighty in deed and word, before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and leaders handed him over to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day, and since these things took place, moreover, some women of our group astounded us. They were at the tomb early this morning, and when they did not find his body there, they came back and told us that they had indeed seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but they did not see him. Then he said to them, 'Oh, how foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have declared. Was it not necessary that the Messiah should suffer these things and then enter into his glory?' Then beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them the things about himself in all of the scriptures. As they came near the village to which they were going, he walked ahead as if he were going on. But they urged him strongly, saying, 'Stay with us, because it is almost evening, and the day is now nearly over.' So he went in to stay with them. And when he was at the table with them, he took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them. Then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him, and he vanished from their sight. They said to each other, 'Were not our hearts burning within us while he was talking to us on the road, while he was opening the scriptures to us?' The same hour they got up and returned to Jerusalem, and they found the 11 and their companions gathered together. They were saying, 'The Lord has risen indeed, and he has appeared to Simon.' Then they told what had happened on the road, and how he had made known to them in the breaking of the bread." This is the truth. We speak with you.
Probably throughout our life. And a lot of the things
But very often we do have our opinions changed and formed by who we walk with. And who we walk with have all kinds of different opinions and interpretations of who Jesus Christ is. Now, these particular two, they had heard wonderful things. They had heard things about Jesus Christ. They knew about his miracles. They were hoping that he was the Messiah, the promised one. And all of this was attached to what they thought the Messiah should be. And they wanted him to be a king that would throw off the control of the Romans. And a few other things, I'm sure. And now they were all confused and bewildered. Because how in the world are they going to deal with their Redeemer, their Messiah, who is now put to death? How are they ever going to throw off their conquerors? And then heard also that some of the women who believed in him had been to the tomb, and they found it empty. Now, just finding an empty tomb doesn't mean somebody had been raised from the dead. I mean, there was a story about that they had paid, someone had paid the soldiers to let people remove the body so they could claim that he was raised from the dead. In the world that we live in, there's many people who don't believe that he was the Messiah, the Son of God. They believe he was a prophet. There are many people in the world that don't even believe he ever even existed, that this is all fabricated, and wishful thinking like all religions. There are those who have different limited ideas of who Jesus is. In fact, that is all of us. All of us have limitations in how much we do believe about Jesus Christ. That when we're going through very rough times, we might decide that if God is an all-loving God, I can't believe in a God who is like this. Or maybe when we're going through rough times, that's when we embrace and accept a deeper understanding of Jesus. In fact, probably throughout our life, it's a mixture of everything. That if you try to describe exactly why you believe and the reasons for it, you might stumble over the words you might want to use. Because something like this is very deep inside of us, that it's not easy to understand at all. You know, there's times when I feel like I'm overloaded with the teachings of who Jesus is, and I like to pick up the simplest catechism that exists, like for second and first graders, and just read through it. Just to remind myself that what is really true about God is profound and profoundly simple. And because our lives are very complicated and difficult to figure out, that means all of our relationships have some kind of complexity to it, and that includes God. These two were allowing Jesus to continue to walk with him. And we might ask ourselves, which one of our friends do we have that if we walk with them and discuss religion, is it usually to justify not following it or accepting things that have nothing to do with his teachings or trying to be affirmed that it's all right to be neglectful, that God has no expectations on us, doesn't wish for anything else to do anything other than just let him love us no matter what? Well, part of that reason is very true. God loves us no matter what. But one of the things that we struggle with, and sometimes deny horribly, is that are we able to love God? And are we able to truly love ourselves and our neighbor and not be obedient to him without accepting him? I mean, there aren't very many hospitals that you can find that were built and run by atheists. There might be now just because they want to prove that they are as charitable, but it's very unlikely that you're going to find great deeds of heroic valor and compassion and mercy and love by those who do not believe in God.
never going to try again to prove that they can be just as good and as kind and loving.
And if you're doing a comparison game, you can win that one,
because there are people who are Christians who are not very nice. I don't know any, but I hear that's the case. Of course, you know I wasn't telling the truth there. Yeah, priests had time to stretch things out a little. But I think you understand what I mean. And we have to accept that equation because he came to take away the sins of the world. He came as a Messiah and Redeemer. The people that he's dealing with are not absolutely perfect. And there's all various degrees of our perfections and the various degrees of the things that we do wrong. For some people, they can be a very evil person, but they can do it in secret that you never know. And there are some people who have habits and difficulties that the whole world knows. We can't go by what we think and in a comparison game. We have to go by, do we let him walk with us? Will we tell him everything about what we think and feel? And will we allow him to transform and change those thoughts that we have when they're not in harmony with what is truly compassionate and merciful and what is healing? You know, we spend a lot of time healing because we need it. Not just physically, but emotionally and within our thoughts. We live in a very chaotic world. And it's interesting, okay? Now they knew about his miracles. Now they knew how he was foretold in the Old Testament. Now they know how it all makes sense intellectually. They were very much aware of the miracles that he worked, people that he had forgiven. And yet, according to the scriptures, they didn't quite know all of him. It wasn't until he blessed the bread and broke it and gave it to them that they were able to see him completely. And I find that very powerful and very symbolic because in Christianity, as in all things, there's a lot of people who believe certain aspects and believe it fervently with a great deal amount of love and affection and commitment. But in the journey of the fullness of the faith, it's completed in the Holy Eucharist. Now, that doesn't mean people who believe in the Holy Eucharist have not abandoned other parts of the scriptures or have ignored it and aren't living it. But if you wanted to look at the full picture, it would all be there. And it's up to us, each and every day. Who do we walk with? What do we listen to? Are we usually in conversations about how we're all hypocrites and God doesn't need any form of worship and you don't have to do a thing? All gods are equal. Jesus never said that. He never pretended to say that. He never gave any indication that it was the fact. Even if we are Christian, we still need his perfecting love. We still need the Holy Spirit. We still need to constantly go to the scriptures. We constantly have to pray and deepen our relationship with him. We have to continue to discuss it in fellowship and together. We need his guiding hand. He's willing to walk. And he does ask us these questions. Not that he doesn't know. When Jesus asks a question, he knows the answer. He's trying to get us to think and concern and discern. But he says, what thing? I ask myself, what beliefs do I have that aren't true? Do I underestimate my talents and gifts? Do I over-exaggerate them? Do I have an image of myself that is distorted? I think we all do it in some ways. Because otherwise we would would never find herself getting angry, or resentful, or jealous, or judgmental, or self-righteous. Those are the signs that we need more and more and more a walk with the Savior, all the way to the breaking of the bread.
Thank you.
We remember the death we brought.
Have compassion on us, have mercy on us in your kindness, and forgive our sins in your mercy. For this your church implores you and through and with you, implores your Father, saying,
have mercy on us, O mighty Father, have mercy on us.
the right service and have perfected it in your good pleasure. By the grace of your only Son and by the descent of your Holy Spirit, sanctify us now, that we be renewed as your spiritual children, so that through hearts and enlightened souls we may call upon your glorious Father and the love of all people, praying.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us
forgive the servers of your divine mysteries and all the faithful who have shared in the sacrifice. Care for the orphans, help the widow, assist the poor and the distressed, satisfy the hungry, and protect all who call upon your holy name in every place. May your name be glorified by that of your Father, and your Holy Spirit, who is good, life-giving, and consubstantial with you, now and forever. Amen. Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessing you have received from the forgiving of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most High Trinity come to you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God who can be glorified forever. Amen. I leave you in peace, O Holy Father,
and I hope you return to you in peace. May the offering I have received from you be for the forgiveness of my faults and the remission of my sins, that I may stand without shame or fear before the throne of Christ. I do not know that I shall be able to return to you again, or offer another sacrifice. I leave you in peace.
I give you the vocation. Vocation icon, pray for vocation for the priesthood. May my God bless us in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.